Shalom, I'm Kahan Tazadaq, Secure Party Creditor, Life Coach, Dating Coach, Certified. I would like to invite you to tune into our weekly podcast every Monday and Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern Standard Time. On Mondays, we will discuss relationships and have special guests. And on Wednesdays, we will discuss commerce, the commercial game, and how to swim in a sea of commerce. From UCC, Secure Party Creditor, Truth Lending, you name it. Contract is law, and law is contract. Be certain to tune into these podcasts every Monday and every Wednesday at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Subscribe, share, and if you would like to be a guest on our podcast, send an email to kahantazadaq7@gmail.com. That is tazadaqkahan7@gmail.com. Thank you. And let's tune.
Shalom. Shalom. Brothers and sisters. And once again, it is your brother Tazadaq. And today's date, according to their calendar, is July 30th, 2014. According to their calendar, at least. And, for the record, this is not legal advice. You know me, I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and then please be advised. This is for educational, informational, and even entertainment purposes. I had an interesting thing happen to me today. I felt a bit excited because I turned my vehicle into a imported car repair shop Friday, a few days ago, and I went to pick it up today, and they agreed to replace the starter and all the necessary components to make my vehicle or my conveyance operational again. However, you know, I go and get my conveyance. They take a while to get it out of the back. I pay the man $790, so I expect my conveyance to perform according to standards, you know, for which I paid, you know, quid pro quo. I give you $790 of this fiat currency, and you put my conveyance back into a properly working state. So I thought, I drove it back to the place of dwellance. And once I got there, I decided to allow the car to run idle for a bit, and the car shut down on its own. After a while, I decided to call Kahan Yakanan and try to jump start the vehicle. It failed to start. So when we proceeded to replace the battery, it failed to start. So we concluded that perhaps the repair was not even done on the conveyance at all. So I'll keep you posted on exactly how that's going to go. But I called the repair shop, and they claimed to have performed everything that was necessary to replace the starter. However, my conveyance is not operating properly, so now we have a problem. So the next thing that I'll do, if I don't receive a call back from them today, I'm going to send out a notice and demand. And then, from there, you know, it's going to get exciting. Nevertheless, at this point, everything's going to go on the record. But nevertheless, what I wanted to talk to you today about, brothers and sisters, exactly what I'm going to actually take them to if they do not repair my vehicle according up to standards. And that is, I'm going to take them into a court of record. And saying thoughts, how many of you actually can actually differentiate between a court of record, which is actually the court of record, and the common law and the state constitutions and state statutes? Can you discern the difference between? Now, according to Black Law's Dictionary, 4th edition, page 425 and 426, common law actions are such as will lie on the particular facts at common law without the aid of a statute. Black Law's Dictionary, 5th edition. Now, court of record. What exactly is it, brothers and sisters? I've done a video a couple years back on this. A court of record is a judicial tribunal having the attribute and exercising functions independently of portions of magistrate designated generally to hold it and the proceedings according to the common law. So a court of record proceeds according to the common law and is absent of the magistrate, many of which you think are judges. It acts and proceeds being enrolled from a perpetual memorial. Jones versus Jones, 188 MOAPP 220. That is a court of record, which is also a common law court. It is absent of the judge or the magistrate. In a court of record, you are entitled to a jury of your peers. I being a man, am entitled to a jury of my peers. Courts may be classified and divided according to several methods. One, courts of record and courts not a record. Now, the former, the court of record, being those who actually act and judicial proceedings are actually enrolled or recorded for a perpetual memorial and testimony, and which have the power to fine or imprison for contempt. Now, errors lie to their judgments, and then they generally possess a seal. Courts not a record are those of inferior dignity. Did you hear me? Courts not a record are those of inferior dignity, which have no power to fine or imprison, and in which the proceedings are actually not enrolled or recorded. Do you understand? Do you understand? So an inferior court or inferior court are those whose jurisdiction is actually limited and special and whose proceedings are not according to the course of the common law. Do you understand? Now, the only inherent difference between ordinarily recognized between superior and inferior courts is that there is a presumption in favor of the validity of the judgment of the former, none in favor of those of the latter, and that the superior court may be shown not to have had power to render a particular judgment by reference to its record. Do you understand? Do you understand? I want you to take note that, however, for example, in California, the Superior Court is a name of a particular court. But when a court acts by virtue of a special statute conferring jurisdiction in a certain class of cases, it is a court of inferior or limited jurisdiction. So although it may have the name Superior Court, it may in fact be an inferior court or a court of limited jurisdiction. For the being time, no matter what its ordinary status may be. Do you understand? So the judgment of a court of record, whose jurisdiction is final, by the way, is as conclusive on all the world as the judgment of this court would be. That's final. It is as conclusive on the court as it is on the other court. It puts an end to the inquiry concerning the fact by deciding it. So, brothers, sisters, court of record must proceed according to the course of the common law. Do you understand? Do you understand? Without the aid of any type of statute, courts which proceed according to statutory jurisdiction are inferior courts and may be sued directly without appealing. Courts designated as courts of record may act as statutory courts unless the parties to the case object. I hope you're hearing me. The judge has no discretion in a court of record. You must understand that. The judge has no discretion in a court of record and can only do material or administrative, should I say, administrative functions. So yeah, the judge has no discretion in a court of record and can actually only do administrative functions such as signing your orders. And no judgment of a court of record can actually be appealed, as it can in these inferior courts. There is no higher court. The type of relief demanded by the plaintiff determines if the court will operate as a court of record or not, on a case-by-case basis. So, this, or should I say, there is no such thing as a common law court. All courts of records can hear actions at common law. Do you understand? And I want you to understand this. All federal courts are courts of record. All federal courts are courts of record. This includes the United States tax court. When you go into a federal tax court, understand that that is a court of record. That is a court of record. Understand that. And almost all state courts are courts of record. Almost all state courts are courts of record. And you can look up and see which one in your state is actually essentially a court of record. Now, according to U.S. Code Title 28, Part 1, Chapter 5, 132, Creation and Composition of the District Courts, it says, there shall be in each judicial district a district court which shall be a court of record known as the United States District Court for the district. Also, according to U.S. Code Title 26, Subtitle F, Chapter 76, Subchapter C, Part 1, 7441 Statute, it says as thus, there is hereby established under Article 1 of the Constitution of the United States a court of record to be known as the United States Tax Court. The member of the tax court shall be the chief justice and the judges of the tax court. So with that being said, brothers and sisters, I want to talk to you a little more about this. I'm going to turn away from the court of record and see that I could actually direct my attention to those of you that may be having legal issues. And perhaps herein, more than likely, you may find some remedy. And if you need further assistance, then hey, I'll be more than glad to assist you if you shoot me an email. But again, this is quid pro quo. So let's proceed on and see if I could actually entertain your intelligence and your thoughts. But keep in mind, I do not like to engage in polemics. In fact, I detest polemics, and I try to actually deter my attention away from it. So if you want to engage in polemics, then you're on the wrong channel.
So, Ak and Akim, and ladies, gents, this is what I suggest to prevent yourselves from continuously getting hung by commercial lynchmen, color of law courts, and the de facto. As with all things, old things begin with Scripture. So I turn your attention to Matthew 5:25, and it says thus, agree with your adversary quickly while you are on the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge hand you over to the officer, and you be thrown into prison. Now this is in the Scripture. And as long as you live by this, brothers and sisters, you will defeat these de facto commercial color of law courts. And one of the other remedies is suggested by the Heavenly Father in the Scripture is Matthew 18:15-17. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of the two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. In this case, I mean in the court. But if he neglect to hear the church, the court, let him be unto thee as an heathen man and publican. Now, brothers and sisters, the Heavenly Father is giving you advice, sound advice, on how to deal with this man, his commercial law court, and the system, or the sewer. Now, a few years ago, let me tell you a story, because most people like stories. Let me tell you a true story. A few years ago, I was, you know, entreating a friend, or entertaining a friend, with my education on this color of law court system and de facto. And he was actually thrown in a box. He was locked up. Now, for the record, this is not legal advice. I do not provide legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and then you please, please, please be advised. But I'll just call my friend Jay. Now, the last time that my friend had a probation hearing with his officer, XYZ, he'd actually go into the meeting personally. Now, before he went, I had actually, you know, written him or assisted him in writing a letter that he actually rewrote in his own handwriting, proving that he was a man. Now, this letter was sent to the probation officer, to the judge, to the prosecutor or the prosecutor, and others, and said that he actually requested that they deliver to him the bonds from the CUSIP, which were actually being used to underwrite his time in prison and his time on probation. Now, he wanted them delivered, the bonds being held by the CUSIP and the other government agencies, so he could actually accept them for settlement and closure. Do you understand? Do you understand what I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters? Now, when he went to his probation officer's meeting, he was disappointed because the probation officer wasn't there at the meeting. He did not meet with him. He filled out a form and he left. And it seemed that no one actually wanted to talk with my friend Jay or meet with him after he asked for the CUSIP bonds so he could actually settle and close the bonds. Now, that is interesting. Now, by the way, you know, the definition of CUSIP is Committee of Uniform Securities Identification Procedures. A CUSIP, to those of you that do not know, a CUSIP number is a 9-digit character alphanumeric code which actually identifies a North American financial security for the purpose of facilitating, clearing, and settling of trades. The CUSIP distribution system is actually owned by the American Bankers Association and is actually operated by S&P Capital IQ. Now, a CUSIP, as I just explained, is actually an acronym. And for educational purposes, all criminal prosecutions is for the purpose of raising revenue for the United States of America, or you're a weirdist. Well, if you're not, you are now, because I just informed you. Now, you'll have a better understanding of why so many of you so-called blacks and you so-called Hispanics are in jails and prison, and why you flood them. Why 80% are filled with you, and why many of you are on probation, and why you're charged with everything from jaywalking on up to murder one in the first degree. Now, I've learned through researching that every American soldier who actually died in places like Afghanistan and Iraq probably carries a $10 million life insurance on him carried by your government, my de facto. Now, after all, every soldier, every Marine, every Air Force personnel, every, you know, Navy personnel is an asset to the United States of America. They have a huge investment in that, in these particular soldiers and their activities, and it can explain why it is that the U.S. was not so anxious to withdraw its troops from Iraq, and why they have begun to send more troops to Iraq again. And it's a money-making activity, and they don't want to talk about the fact that they are making money on the deaths of these military personnel, and that they are making money on the incarceration and imprisonment on otherwise good-hearted people. Many of you are innocent. You was charged with something. What does charge means? To impose a duty upon. Many of you laugh when I tell you that they had me on their list. But I'm serious. I've gotten a few fear tactics from the alphabet group. Now, I had been finding out who the investor is and the 144 holders. Now, they have actually a rule called the 144 holder. Now, the rule is that they can't prohibit them from selling the prison bonds. They have to wait 6 months before they can sell a certain quantity of private securities without being registered selling them as private securities. So basically, there were 8 people on the board of directors of the CCA, the Corrections Corporation of America. But now, I see that there's 11 when I just checked a few days ago. Joseph E. Russell, the top holder, and John M. Ferguson. Now, Russell, at the last time I checked, owned 64,000 shares of CCA stock, which is worth $70 million. Ferguson owned 34,000 shares valued at $37 million. And this may have changed by now since I've last checked, because Ferguson now seemed to be listed as chairman of the board. Now, Fidelity Management and Research was a top stockholder that may have also changed. Now, the top investment firm that is selling these bonds as investment securities, they pool them and then they sell them as mortgage-backed securities. They also, when they pool them, they sell them as mutual funds on the stock market. So, by pooling, what I mean is the securities of these inmates. So, what they are doing, brothers and sisters, essentially, is they are actually taking the mortgage-backed securities, which are really bid bonds, performance bonds, and payments bonds. So, they pool these bonds, and when they pool them together, they call them mortgage-backed securities. they take these to the TBA, which is the Bond Market Association, and it's an actual market for bonds. And anytime a bond is issued there, there has to be an underwriter. And the bonds actually have to be underwritten. So bonds that are actually issued have to be indemnified. So there has to be surety to indemnify the bonds. Indemnify the bonds. So the brokerage houses and the insurance companies indemnify the bonds. And they're calling them surety companies. Surety companies. Oh, there's a, you have been deceived, people. Now, after the surety companies identify the bonds, which is underwriting them, they do this through an investment banker, or the banks themselves do this. So their job, or they job, should I say, they job it out to them. And they buy up all these shares and turn around and sell them as investment securities. Now, the shares represents the stocks, which represents the account of the CCA. Now, all of this has been funneled through the CCA, the Corrections Corporations of America. That's why so many of you so-called blacks and Hispanics are filling those these prisons. They're making millions off of you. Millions off of you. That's why they want to keep you in the court system. So what they are doing is selling stocks in the prison system by selling the prisoners' accounts as securities through the securities exchange. Listen, they are making huge amounts of money off of it. They privatize the prisoners' accounts and bring all these investors in, and what they're doing is underwriting all these prisoners' accounts with the bonds. So, brothers and sisters, this is after the surety company guarantees the bonds. So they are actually underwritten through an investment bank or banker. The world bankers. A wicked clique of criminals. Then they are actually put out on the market and resold to the public. So in other words, the banks are buying up all the shares and then they resell them as investment securities to the public. The public then buys them as mutual funds, or they can buy them as debt instruments, equity instruments. So what they're really doing is they are buying up debt instruments. They are using the physical accounting cycle of the accrual, and they sell the prisoner's capital and invest, or should I say entrance, as it is called in the accrual accounting. They resell these to the public because the prisoners did not do the full settlement and closure on the account. So they sell the prisoner account as a commercial dishonor and sell it to the public as a commercial dishonor. So when you go in the courts, they always say that they are operating under a statute jurisdiction. And Black's Law's Dictionary, 4th edition, says a statute is a bond of obligation of record. So that's what all the criminal statutes are. Bonds of obligation of record, folks. You're being had. So go in and read the definition of a reconnaissance bond, and you will find that it is a bond of obligation, a record. But don't believe me? Go and check it out for yourselves. They're selling bonds, folks. They're selling bonds. They are charging prisoners under a bond. The prisoner signs the bond, and the bond becomes an agreement for the payback. This is done when the prisoner signs the final court papers at a sentencing hearing. Do you understand? Do you understand? So just how many of us, through research, have learned that government attempted to finance from the private sectors during the Second World War? How many of us learned that? Not very many. Weren't they selling war bonds then? They were soaking up the people's equity in terms of buying bonds, transferring your funds to the government. The government, by purchasing those bonds, were actually promising to pay you back your investment at some time in the future with interest. Now, at that time, they were collecting from the people as their so-called cash equity. Now, the people have gotten too poor. So, since the people have gotten too poor, too stingy, too smart to buy bonds to finance the government, how long has it been since you heard of the post office, or anyone for that matter, trying to get you down to buy U.S. savings bond? Not very often. So what they are doing now, instead of getting you to voluntarily give your cash equity to the government for a promise to be paid back in the future, they're securing from us some violation of a statute by which the law ascribes from us a penalty, i.e. payment of a sum of money due. So instead of collecting the cash from us, they put us through a criminal procedure where we dishonored the system. And what is happening is they are selling our capital and our interests. So in other words, folks, they are selling the liability you had and whatever charge was brought against your straw man. Do you understand? Do you understand? Well, I hope you do. Because if you don't, folks, you are finished. You are finished. So they are actually taking the capital and interest that you should pay and are grabbing that from us and selling it on an open market to bankers and investors to transfer their funds to governments, which is actually covered by the bonds, by the bond, a violation of your straw man of that statute. So in order to secure the bond, the living soul is actually placed in prison as the surety to back the bond, which is financed on the investment of the public market in terms of sales of stocks and bonds. So the public does not directly bid on the prisoner's debt. Your debt is actually assumed by the bankers. The bankers issue secondary paper that actually allows me to invest in what they are holding, as the holder is due course of the claim against your straw man, against your corporate construct, against your corporate fiction. So the reason they're doing this is because you dishonored the post-settlement procedure for settlement and closure of the account. So the prisoner should have come in and accept it and use his exemption. Since the prisoner dishonored the post-settlement procedure, the prisoner is in dishonor, and the insurance of the bonds by financing the system was done in order to pass the punishment on to him because of his inability to fulfill his post-settlement objectives. Do you understand? So if you get into dishonor by non-acceptance, what they are trying to do is to get an acceptor, which is the same thing as a banker. They need someone to pay off the obligation, and if you get into dishonor, they sell your dishonor and put you in the prison. They throw you into the box and lock you up as a collateral, and then they sell the bond. So the bond is actually issued, and they get a surety, an underwriter, to underwrite the performance of the payment bond. So what a bid bond. This is what's going on. So what the performance bond does is guarantee the bid contract or the bid bond. So what the bid bond does is guarantee the payment of the performance bond. And this is done through a surety company. And they get an underwriter or an investment banker to underwrite it. And after it is underwritten, they sell it to the public as an investment security, debt instrument, or a mutual backed securities. And all of this is done through bonds, through bonding. That's why all these so many municipal bonds are in place. What they're doing is following everything through the prison system. And the prison system is actually being privatized. That's why you see so many private prisons coming up. Through privatizations, private enterprise can actually fund the prison system cheaper than the federal government can. So they have subsidized everything through privatization. And ALEC, A-L-E-C, does this, the American Legislative Exchange Council, and it promotes privatization through foundations like Reasons Foundations, owned by David Knox. They get the foundations to promote this and get investors to come in. And Cornell was merged with Trinity Virtual Company, which is an investment company. And what they did was change their name to Reed Trinity Vester. And then they merged with SB Warburg. And Warburg was out of Germany and France and partner with the Rothschilds. And SB Warburg is in Chicago, Illinois, and they merge with BIF in Switzerland, which is actually a settlement and closure bank and the biggest bank in the world for settlements. Brothers and sisters, you're being had. And they connected to Cornell Company, which is owned by David Cornell. Now, everyone is tied in. Payne Webber Group, the Payne Webber Group, is the United States of America and all big international corporations, stockholders, and own all stocks in CCA. So everyone is using our exemptions on the private side. They fill a 1096 tax return and show it is a prepaid account. And as prepaid interest, they return it back to the prisoner. They took the prisoner's deductions from the exemption and they deducted the tax, and the IRS bills the prisoner for the tax. So the corporations are stealing your exemptions, which is your intellectual property. So what's wrong with this? They are not telling you what they're doing. It's all commercial. When you go into a courtroom, everything is commercial. I've told you consistently, the facts don't matter. The facts are on the moon. So what matters is honor and dishonor. The courts have to dishonor the potential prisoner to get the person to argue, or to get the person's attorney to argue, just like Martha Stewart did. Argue and you're in dishonor and you're end up in jail or prison. I told you years ago, there's four doors that you could go through: acceptance, conditional acceptance, argue, and silence. Most people love to argue. You hire an attorney and you get into arguments and you go to jail. The attorneys are actors to make you think that the whole process is an factual issue. They get us into this guilty, not guilty mode, and they get us into the cloak and dagger or who, whatever evidence to present. It's a dog and pony show, folks, to cover up what are after the debt money. Ask the attorney, according to CJS 7, is his first obligation to the court. All corporations work on a financial accounting year, which means that they suspend debt. They cannot get rid of debt and balance the book unless they run it through an accountant, run it through our accounts on the private side. We, the people, run a calendar year, and corporations run a fiscal year. They can only balance their books if it is run through our accounts using our exemptions. They can do their reverse bookkeeping entries and go to post-settlement and closure. They can't do that until the prisoners do the acceptance, if they do it. Now, that's what they're looking for in the courtroom under 3-410. Is the acceptor. And that means we're actually assuming the liability for the debt as the principal. So a lot of time, folks, with debt, the principal is always the primary litigant in the commercial setting. He has to assume the liability, then get your remedy. Otherwise, you don't get a remedy. So they sell your account to some corporation while you're sitting in prison. Now, how many times has the government ever had a case against anyone? The attorney had to attempt to get you to go right into argument and trial and then go into dishonor. So, I, brothers and sisters, was, you know, given help to Jay, and, you know, was given a document from Rosewood Trust on a mortgage foreclosure. And this person did a conditional acceptance and did a heck of a job and stopped them cold and took the property off the market. And at the end, my friend said that they did not answer within 14 days. They was going to resort to notarial protest and get remedy for dishonor. So my friend went into the fact that their charter doesn't allow them to loan credit, and that my friend wanted to know the name, the company, and the source of the credit, and my friend wanted to know the account number, and my friend wanted to know, wanted the certified copies of the front and back of the promissory note. And my friend was trying to get them to divulge that it was their secured party creditor that was the source of everything that these crooks was doing. And my friend was actually focusing, forcing them, should I say, to admit that it was her promissory note that was the basics of the credit instrument that they loaned, and they had already sold the note to someone else, and they didn't have it in their possession. Do you understand? So what they do is they sell the notes just as they do when you go into prison. They endorse the notes, and they no longer hold, or no longer the holder of the note. The mortgage company wasn't involved in the process. The attorneys are doing this. They are doing, what they are doing is coming to the private side to get the debt without any permission from the mortgage company. So in this case, they quoted from the UCC, and it's the lex of the merchant law. Lex Macaria of the law of merchant. So if you read John Hall's book, it actually talks about the letter rogatory indictments, where you are actually indicted and brought into a court under a warrant. What is a warrant? It is a demand for payment or debt, of debt. So what they did under Admiralty in the courtroom is they are demanding payment. You sign a bond to release until the civil complaint is prosecuted, and then they release you under the bond until the civil bond is prosecuted. And if you didn't pay the debt, they put you in prison until the debt is paid. They use the same terms in this practice book from 1700s. This is an actual practice. There's an actual practice book. It is written by courts practice who work in the courts of Archie's from the Crown as registrant. This is a private book, folks, not meant for public viewing. It's law. It actually laws out the whole practice of the Admiralty during the American Revolution. Now, Hall translated this and put it in the district court in Maryland in 1809. This was actually written in 1692. It is the actual practice. And Benedict is not a practice. It gives information about what Admiralty really is. Admiralty is all debt and it's all civil. It becomes criminal when the prisoner gets a contempt charge when he refuses to pay. So they can keep you in jail until you pay the debt. So the initial get out of jail bond releases you until you've successfully paid the debt. This book goes into the history and practice of Admiralty. It tells you how to set the bond and do the courtroom procedure. The laws haven't changed. The circumstances of government have changed so Admiralty can be applied instead of the constitutional law. Do you understand? So wardens come from Admiralty wardens of the sea. The warden is the warehouse man who's actually warehousing all the goods. He's the bailee. The commitment order is your bailment, your contract for the commitment, the goods. Then they put the goods in a warehouse and store them there. The prisoners stored in prison, just like people stored in pods in the movie The Matrix. And that's how this thing is going down, folks. It's all about commerce. So if you have loved ones that are unjustly confined, you may want to listen to this video several times. And pass this on. Education, proper education, is the only way to defeat a de facto and a color law system. Once again, my name is Tazadaq, and my email is here if you want to reach me. And I'm going to say shalom and peace to you all.